فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. In this sit, inshallah ta'ala, I hope بإذن الله الكريم to talk about a very important topic. And that topic is فهم العلم وضبطه أهميته وسبل تحقيقه. The topic that I want to speak about is understanding, comprehending knowledge and how important it is and the way to gain it. If you don't have it, the way to gain the ability to comprehend knowledge. And in reality, I do not want to speak about عن فضل العلم والعلماء. I do not want to speak about the virtue of knowledge and the virtues of scholars and the scholars and the people of knowledge, because I've spoken about that in many other sits. And the virtue of knowledge is something, inshallah ta'ala, that is very common, well known by everybody. Everybody who has ever read the Quran, who's looked at the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, knows the virtue of knowledge and how important it is. And the knowledge that I'm referring to here is the Islamic knowledge, of course. So I'm not going to speak about the virtue of knowledge and the virtue of the people of knowledge. But there is a statement that I do want to bring to your attentions, and that is the statement of Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah. He said, ليس عمل بعد الفرائض أفضل من طلب العلم. Sufyan al-Thawri said, there is no action after the obligatory act. There is no action after the obligatory act that is more virtuous than seeking knowledge. After you pray the salah, after you fast, after you go hajj, after you give your zakat, and other acts that are obligatory, there's nothing that comes before or more virtuous than seeking knowledge. So what this tells us is that knowledge is أعظم القربات, the greatest thing that a person can get closer to Allah with. And it is from the, it's from the greatest things you can get closer to Allah with, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the greatest acts of worships, it's from those great acts of worships a person can get closer to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala with. ولذلك الإمام أحمد بن حنبل said, العلم لا يعدله شيء. Knowledge, there's nothing equivalent to it, there's nothing like it. لمن صحت نيته, but it is for the person whose intentions is good. So Imam Ahmed said, there's nothing like knowledge if you have good intentions. So any person, فمن كانت نيته صالحة, anybody whose intention is righteous or خالصة, pure, for the sake of Allah تبارك وتعالى, then this particular person, there's nothing greater that he can embark on, and there's nothing greater than what he is taking forward or doing than seeking knowledge. And the reason why is because it's مفتاح كل خير, every key to good, knowledge is the forefront for it. So inshallah ta'ala, those two statements of those two noble imams, Sufyan al-Thawri statement and Ahmad ibn Hanbal, will give you an understanding of the virtue of knowledge. And of course, as I said, that is something that you will find in the Kitab and the Sunnah, the virtue of knowledge and the virtue of the people of knowledge. But that's not my topic today. My topic inshallah ta'ala that I want to speak about in this muhadara, in this lecture, is the issue of understanding knowledge. And this is a part of, it's a chapter that falls under knowledge or gaining knowledge, or the things that a person needs to gain knowledge. وَلِذَلَكَ الْإِمَامِ الشَّافِعِي, what did he say? أخي لن تنال العلم إلا بستة سأنبيك عن تفصيلها ببياني. Six things is the way a person can obtain and gain knowledge. From those six is understanding and comprehending the religion, comprehending knowledge, understanding knowledge. So our discussion and our talk is about an important topic connected to knowledge, which is فهم العلم, understanding knowledge. If we look around today, we realize the people who have embarked on wanting to gain knowledge are large in number. السالكون طريق العلم كثيرون. The people who have embarked on the path of wanting to gain knowledge are a lot in number. Go to the Arab world today, go to Al-Azhar University, go to Umm al-Qura, Jamiat al-Riyab, Malik Saud, Jamiat al-Imam, go to Medina University and other universities around the Muslim world. And look at the number of people you will see who are enrolling, who are already studying there, and the ones who are applying, it's a large amount. Alhamdulillah. It's something that brings happiness and joy to the heart. But لكن الثابتين على طريق طلب العلم والاستزادة منه قليلون. But the ones who are steadfast on seeking knowledge, in wanting to increase in knowledge, are very little in number. So those who take the path of wanting to gain knowledge, applying for universities and wanting to study and going and enrolling and whatnot, are large. But the ones who are steadfast on that road, who are consistent, who don't stop learning, they know that that studying doesn't have no end point, that it's continuous, those are little in number. They're not a lot. And then from within those who are little, those little ones who are steadfast, within them is a little minority again, who are what? Who've actually even understood knowledge. وَالضَّابِطُونَ لِلْعِلْمِ مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ ثَابِتِينَ قَلِيلُونَ أَيْضًا. And those who have understood knowledge within those who are steadfast are very little. So we see the importance of the importance it is to actually comprehend and understand knowledge. Understanding knowledge, it is the objective of what knowledge is. And it is the ultimate goal of what knowledge is to actually understand it and comprehend it. It is not memorizing. And that is not me belittling the importance of memorizing. But it's not you memorizing hifdul masail, that you memorize this mas'ala, this mas'ala. Rather, what it is ma'rifatu usul al-ilm. You know the foundations of knowledge. وقواعده وكلياته التي تتفرع عنها أما منها الجزئيات. You know the foundations and you know the principles where all of these sub-branches have been derived from. And if my beloved brothers and sisters, you don't have understanding, لا يتمكن الإنسان من القياس. You can never do analogy. كما لا يتمكن من الاستنباط والحكم الصحيح من المسائل ورد الشبهات حول مسائل العلم. And you won't also have the ability to extract ruling from the Kitab and the Sunnah. And you will not also conclude with a correct ruling in matters of the religion you speak about. You will also not be correct in responding and defending and debunking doubts that are thrown at Islam. You won't be able to debunk it and refute it and respond to it. You'll also not be able, without understanding and comprehending, you'll be a person whose mistakes are more than the things that he gets right. And also, you will have tanaqud, contradictions. And how would you have contradictions? تفريق بين المتماثلين والتسوية بين المختلفتين. Two things that are the same, you're going to divide between the two of them. And you're going to place each one with a different ruling when they're the same. Or you're going to bring together two things that are different and give them both the same ruling. تناقضات, contradiction is going to happen. And why is that? It's because you don't have understanding, you don't have ضبط, And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. And he states subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says in the Quran, in Surah Ankabut, ayah 43, Allah says, وَتِلْكَ الْأَمْثَالُ نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ وَمَا يَعَقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ Allah says, and like that we give parables. نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ We give these parables for the people. وَمَا يَعْقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ And no one, يَعْقِلُهَا means أَيَفَهَمُهَا No one understands it except the people of knowledge. So this ayah, what does it show? فَدَلَّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ الْعَالِمُ لَا يَكُونُ عَالِمًا إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ صَاحِبَ فَهْمٍ That a scholar is not a true scholar until he understands. And my beloved brothers and sisters, look, just because a person has memorized Masail, that doesn't necessarily make him a person of knowledge. What makes him a scholar is الفهم وضبط المسائل أصوله وقواعده. He knows the أصول of this knowledge. He knows the principles that it stands on. التي تتفرع منها الجزئيات. That all these sub-branches is coming out from, he knows exactly the أصول that it's coming out from. Based on this ayah. As for the general mass, for them, they won't understand Allah's parables and Allah's amthila. وَتِلْكَ الْأَمْثَالُ نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ وَمَا عَقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ There's an ayah in the Quran that proves the general mass, they get confused with Allah. ولذلك, what did the Jews say? And the disbelievers? إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحِي أَنْ يَضْرِبَ مَثَلًا مَا بَعُوضَةً فَمَا فَوْقَهَا فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَيَقُولُونَ مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا The disbelievers, their response is when they look at Allah's parables and examples that He gives, ماذا أراد الله بهذا مثلا What did Allah intend behind this parable He's given? It's not making sense. One time He's talking about ba'uda, one time He's talking about this, whatever. What is this that He's trying to say? You see, they don't understand it. They don't comprehend it. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَدَاوُودَ وَسُلَيْمَانَ إِذْ يَحْكُمَانِ فِي الْحَرْثِ إِذْ نَفَشَتْ فِيهِ غَنَمُ الْقَوْمِ وَكُنَّا لِحُكْمِهِمْ شَاهِدِينَ فَفَهَّمْنَاهَا سُلَيْمَانَ وَكُلًّا آتَيْنَا حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا Allah tells us, وداود وسليمان إذ يحكمان في الحرب. Namely, like Dawood and Sulaiman, they judged a matter. The father, Dawood, got it wrong. And Sulaiman got it right. Allah then says, ففهمناها سليمان وكلا آتيناه حكما وعلما. This matter, Dawood didn't understand it. Nabiullah Sulaiman understood it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is saying, we gave Sulaiman the understanding here. But both of them, we've given them what? حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا Both of them have knowledge and both of them were rulers and they had judges. They were judged. But look, the understanding he was given to Sulaiman. When Sulaiman is the son and the father is Dawood. Sulaiman is younger. Dawood is older because he's the father. But this shows you that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He gave Sulaiman the understanding in this particular situation. Also Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He says in the Quran, in Surah Yusuf ayah 2, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ Allah says, we sent down, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ We sent this Qur'an, قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ We sent down this Qur'an in the Arabic language. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ أي, the word عقل is meant here, والمراد بالعقل هنا is what? الفهمُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَفْهَمُونَ So you can understand, that you can comprehend. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, يُؤْتِ الْحِكْمَةَ مَنْ يَشَاءُ Allah gives wisdom to whoever He wills. وَمَنْ يُؤْتَ الْحِكْمَةَ فَقَدْ أُوْتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا And whoever is given wisdom, then he has been given a lot of good. What is the wisdom? We hear this common use of the word wisdom. What does the Sharia observe wisdom as? And what is hikmah? Abdullah ibn Abbas, ترجمان القرآن, the commenter of this Quran, the great noble companion, what did he refer? He said, الحكمة, wisdom is القرآن, the book of Allah. والفهم فيه and comprehending it. Wisdom is the Quran and understanding the Quran. So if you understand the book of Allah, then you're upon wisdom. And you know the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, what did he do dua for? Nabiullah, what did the Prophet do dua for? Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. Abdullah ibn Abbas, what did the Prophet make dua for him? Allahumma faqqihu fi din wa allimhu ta'wil. Allahumma faqqihu. Oh Allah, give him understanding. Give Ibn Abbas understanding of the religion. And also teach him the commentary of the Quran. So what does this show us? That the issue is about understanding. And there are the many texts that prove that how important the issue of understanding and comprehending is important. A person may be carrying knowledge. A person, وَالْإِنسَانُ قَدْ يَكُونُ حَامِلًا لِلْعِلْمِ. He's carrying knowledge with him. حَافِظًا لِلْمَسَائِلِ. You see? But لَكِ لَيْسَ لَدَيْهِ فِقْهٌ وَلَا فَهْمٌ. He has no comprehension of what he's carrying. And the Prophet told us this, عليه الصلاة والسلام. He said, نَظَّرَ اللَّهُمْ رَأَنْ. May Allah glow the face of a person. سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي. Who hears my statement. This is the hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. فَوَعَاهَا. He holds it. وَحَفِظَهَا. And he memorizes it. وَبَلَّغَهَا. And he conveys it. His issue is al-wa'i. His wa'i. فَوَعَاهَا is like a vessel where you pour water into a cup. The cup will hold it for you. So he holds it. وَحَفِظَهَا. And he memorizes it. وَبَلَّغَهَا. And then he conveys it. That's what he is. He has no understanding. He's a holder. He's holding the knowledge. فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَفْقَهُ مِنْ. For verily, فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ. A person who is carrying that knowledge sometimes may pass it to a person who knows it more than he does. He'll say, just give me the hadith, what is it? Jazakallah. And he will extract 50, 20, 70, 80, 90 masail from this one hadith. Because he's understanding. But this one's memorized it for him. فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَفْقَهُ مِنْهُ. This person passes it over to this other person, he memorizes. He himself may have understanding of it, no problem. Sometimes he may understand it. But this person who he's passing it over to has more understanding than he does. ولذلك there used to be a man who used to be called حِمَارُ الْفُرُوحِ. The reason why they called him is because the Kitab al-Furu' by Ibn Muflih, which is a fiqh, Hanbali book, it was said that he memorized all the time of his head. He knew it all. And they used to just ask him to read it on them, and they used to extract it and explain it. He was a memorizer, he didn't understand it. He was a donkey in the fact that he was just carrying the book, but he didn't understand it. He didn't understand what he had memorized. So what does this mean? The one who transmits an information to you doesn't necessarily mean he understood it. Another person may hear it and be able to extract more from it. And the Prophet said, وَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ لَيْسَ بِفَقِيهٍ. And sometimes a person may even convey it and he has no understanding at all. Zero. He's just the person who memorized it. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was given a distinct thing that he was prioritized over the other companions. And what was that, my beloved brothers and sisters? It was understanding and comprehension. Abu Bakr. ولذلك when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, عَبْدًا a slave, خَيَّرَهُ اللَّهُ بَيْنَ زَهْرَةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ فَاخْتَارَ مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. A slave was given the choice. The Prophet said this in a gathering. He said a slave was given a choice between this world and that which is with Allah. And that slave chose that which was with Allah. And Abu Bakr started to cry. And then he said, فَدَيْنَاكَ. He said, فَدَيْنَاكَ بِآبَائِنَا وَأُمَّهَاتِنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. We have freed our mothers and our fathers for you. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was from the people in the gathering, he said, why is Abu Bakr crying for? The Prophet only spoke about a slave who was given a choice between living in this world and staying and dwelling in this world, or what is with Allah. And this slave chose what is with Allah. So what's there to cry about? But then later they realized that what Abu Bakr understood was that the Prophet, when he had said that, he was referring to himself. In other words, the Prophet was trying to say, I am coming to an end. My life is going to stop. I'm going to die. And so I was given the choice in wanting to live in this world or the hereafter, and I have chosen the hereafter. And that's where Abu Sa'id al-Khudri said his statement, كَانَ أَبُو بَكَرَ أَعْلَمَنَا بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Abu Bakr was the one who knew most and was more knowledgeable than all of us in the affairs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What does he mean? أَعْلَمَنَا بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ. He means a كَانَ أَفْهَمَ لِكَلَامِهِ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَسَلَّمُ. He is the one who understood the Prophet the most, because he lived with him the most. He spent the most time with him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. So he understood the messenger. And he knew when the Prophet said things, what he meant by it. Abu Bakr. Because he had that faham, understanding and comprehension. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he wrote a letter to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. Umar radiallahu anhu wrote a letter to the noble companion Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. And Abu Musa al-Ash'ari at this particular time, Umar appointed him as a governor in Iraq. وَقَدْ وَلَّاهُ عَلَىٰ بَعْضِ نَوَاحِ الْعِرَاقِ. In some of the land of Iraq, Abu Bakr appointed Abu Musa al-Ash'ari as a leader. And he sent him a letter that he wrote to him. And this is what he wrote in the letter for him. He said to him, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, الْفَهْمُ الْفَهْمُ. الْفَهْمُ الْفَهْمُ. Understand. What does he mean, al-fahm ul-fahm? Ay ihris al-fahm. Strive to understanding. Ihris ala fahm al-masail. Strive to understanding the issues. La hifdaha, don't just strive to memorizing it. The same with Ali ibn Abi Talib when he was asked in Kufa. He said to him, Hal khassakum Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bi shay'in dun an-nas? Is there anything that the Prophet specified you with? Is there anything that the Prophet uniquely gave to you over everyone else? Is there something you only have that no one else shares with you, Ali? As a family, because you're from the Prophet's family. Is there anything he done for you that he gave you and he told you that no one else knows? And then Ali ibn Abi Talib responded by saying, La, no. وَالَّذِي فَلَقَ الْحَبَّةِ وَبَرَأَ النَّسَمَةِ إِلَّا فَهْمًا يُؤْتِيهِ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا فِي كِتَابٍ وَمَا فِي هَذِهِ الصَّحِيفَةِ. I swear by Allah. No. Except an understanding Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gives a slave in the Quran. No, the Prophet never specified me with anything. The only thing is everybody and his understanding of the Book of Allah. Would you understand? Would you understand? That's it. And then he goes on saying, وَمَا فِي هَذِهِ الصَّحِيفَةِ. And also what's in this script, or a manuscript, or a little scroll that he was holding. So what is Ali ibn Abi Talib saying? The issue is not, the Prophet didn't specify everybody with something, but it's everyone and his understanding of what the Prophet said. So I bring back to your attention, my beloved brothers and sisters, don't be deceived, okay? And don't be fooled because of somebody's excessive memorization or somebody's excessive reading and research. It shouldn't amaze you. What should amaze you is understanding of a mas'ala, how that person understood it. Or yourself. Have you understood this mas'ala? Have you got to the bottom of it and you comprehended it properly? And a lot of the times, just because a lot of the youngsters and the youths, they see a person who's memorized so many ahadith, or he's memorized so much, they fall for it. And they look at this person as a scholar, and a person of ilm, or they see a person who's muttali', who reads a lot. And so they fall for it, and they say, he's a scholar. He's an alim. He's a person of knowledge. When in the reality, when in reality the issue is what? The issue is al-fahm, al-fahm. Understanding. And that's what Imam Malik said. Imam Malik said, إِنَّ الْعِلْمَ لَيْسَ بِكَثْرَةِ الرِّوَايَةِ. Knowledge is not the one who narrates more. إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمَ نُورٌ يَقْذِفُ اللَّهُ فِي الْقَلْبِ. Rather, knowledge is a light Allah places in the person's heart. In other words, understanding. And Ahmed ibn Salih al-Misri, who's been Ashabi Malik, and Imam Malik is Ashab, he explains to us what Imam Malik meant by this statement. إِنَّ الْعِلْمَ لَيْسَ بِكَثْرَةِ الرِّوَايَةِ. That knowledge is not the one who narrates more. إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ نُورٌ يَقْذِفُ اللَّهُ فِي الْقَلْبِ. He explains to us what it means. He says it means, and Imam Malik meant by it, يُرِيدُ بِهِ فَهْمَ الْعِلْمِ وَمَعْرِفَةِ مَعَانِيهِ. He means by it understanding knowledge. And understanding the meanings that are in it. So according to Imam Malik, knowledge is not the one who memorizes. Necessarily. Rather, it's all about understanding and comprehension. What have you understood? It's not how many books you got. It's not how many books you're carrying. It's not how many narrations you have. It's really about what have you understood and what have you comprehended. So again, my beloved brothers and sisters, العلم هو الفهم. Knowledge is understanding and comprehending. Understanding كلام الله, Allah سبحانه وتعالى speech. وكلام رسوله, and the speech of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And both of the كلام of Allah, the speech of Allah, and the speech of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم يضبط ذلك وفق أصول العلم وقواعده. It's all in accordance to the foundations and the principles of the people of knowledge. That every dalala of this nusus, dalalatul alfad, dalalatul iltizam, dalalatul tadammul, dalalatul iltizam, dalalatul mutabaqa, it's all in accordance. And that every nas, you proper understand what it means. Correctly, based upon, is it عام, is it خاص, is it مجمل, is it مبين, is it محكم, is it متشابه, and how, is it ظاهر, is it مؤول, is it نص, all of those, you have it properly. If you're doing تخريج of hadith, you go according to the أصول and the قواعد of the people of hadith. And that you understand what they mean by when they say things. And inshallah ta'ala, examples I'm going to be giving you excessively to show you how people don't understand masail al-ilm. Talabatul ilm. Some dakatira, doctor, some problems they fall into because fahmul ilm. Ibn Abdul Barr said something in support of what I've just mentioned. He says, وَالَّذِي عَلَيْهِ جَمَاعَةُ فُقَهَاءِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. The scholars, the jurists, the majority of them are of, and this is what they say, ulama, ذَمُّ الْإِكْثَارِ دُونَ تَفَقُّهٍ وَلَا تَدَبُّرٍ. This is what the scholars are upon, which is what? Rebuking a person in increasing knowledge without understanding what he previously took. Don't take on more if you haven't understood your previous knowledge. If what you've already taken before, you don't even have it in your brain and you haven't understood it. Because the issue is al-fahm wal-fahm, understanding and comprehending. Al-Imam al-Khatib al-Baghdadi rahimahullah. Ibn Abd al-Barr is what? Hafiz al-Maghrib. Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi is Hafiz al-Mashriq. So both of them, we tend to always mention them together. Khatib al-Baghdadi, what did he say? He said, إن العلم هو الفهم والدراية. Knowledge is about understanding and comprehending. وليس الإكثار والتوسع في الرواية. And it is not increasing in the issues of narrations. Going too much into it without having any understanding of it. Some people, what they do is, they want to memorize the Rijal, and they want to memorize the Anisanid, and they want to memorize, which is good. But he doesn't even understand what the Prophet is saying here. And he doesn't understand the matan of the Hadith, what the Prophet is instructing here. He doesn't understand it. This is a mushkila. ولذلك ابن القيم رحمه الله says فالفهم نعمة من الله على عبده understanding is a blessing from Allah upon his slaves. وَنُورٌ يَقْذِفُ اللَّهُ فِي قَلْبِهِ. And it is a light that Allah places and throws in the heart of a person who he loves. يَعْرِفُ بِهِ وَيُدْرِكُ مَا لَا يُدْرِكُ غَيْرُ. And with this light, he starts to understand and comprehend that which others can't comprehend. وَلَا يَعْرِفُ فَيَفْهَمُ مِنَ النَّصِ. So this person, look how Allah has blessed him so much. فَيَفْهَمُ مِنَ النَّصِ. He starts to understand from the text مَا لَا يَفْهَمُ غَيْرُ. Other people can't even understand this from it. Allah has given him the ability to understand this from it. You see, مَعَ اسْتِوَهِمَا فِي حِفْظِهِ وَفَهَمِ أَصْلِ مَعْنَاهِ. Even though the other people, they share memorization with him, and they all share the fundamental understanding, but then he has some extra understanding which Allah has uniquely given to him. You see? فَالْفَهَمُ عَنِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ عِنْوَانُ الصِّدِّيقِيَّةِ وَمَنْشُورَةُ الْوِلَايَةُ النَّبَوِيَّةِ وَفِي تَفَاوَتَتْ مَرَاتِبُ الْعُلَمَاءِ حَتَّى عُدَّ أَلْفٌ بِوَاحِدٍ. Understanding what Allah and His Messenger are saying is the title of Siddiqiyya. And it is also the station and the positions that the prophets and messengers have held. And based on understanding تَفَاوَتَتْ مَرَاتِبُ الْعُلَمَاءِ, the stages and the levels of scholars differed. They were not all the same. Based on what? Al-Fahm. Based on understanding. حَتَّى عُدَّ أَلْف بِوَاحِدٍ. Until 1,000 scholars or 1,000 of them became equal to one. 1,000 became equal to one. Because how much understanding and comprehension he had. So my beloved brothers and sisters, الْعِلْمُ, knowledge, لَيْسَ كَثْرَةُ الْمَحْفُوظَاتِ. It is not about memorization of excessive number of things. وَلَا سِعَةُ الْإِطِّلَاعِ. And it is not how much books have you read and how much rasail have you gone through. No, it's not. And it is also not وَلَا اسْتِكْثَارُ مِنَ الشُّيُوخِ وَالدُّرُوسِ. I went to this halaqa and I met this shaykh and he's one of my teachers and so is my teacher and so is my teacher. That's not knowledge. بل العلم في حقيقة الأمر. But knowledge in its real essence is what? هو الضبط والفهم فيه لا غير. It is precision. It is precision in knowledge, accuracy in knowledge, and understanding and comprehending it. Nothing else. That's what it bottles down to. Now, I am not saying that one should not read. كلا ثم كلا. And I am not saying a person should not memorize. And I am not saying a person shouldn't increase in the number of scholars he goes to and he takes knowledge from. Ever then, I'm not saying this. But I'm saying the asal of knowledge and the true essence of knowledge is al-fahmu wa-dabdu fihi. It is precision in knowledge and understanding and comprehending knowledge. Wallahi, anyone who does not understand knowledge, تخبط في أحكامي وفتاوي. You will start to see how awkward and how contradicting his rulings and verdicts are. والتبس عليه المسائل. And issues start to mix up with for him. And that individual فيفرق بين المتماثلات. You start to see him dividing between things that are the same. وَيُسَوِّي بَيْنَ الْمُفْتَرِقَاتِ. And then he makes the two opposites, he tries to bring them together. Or he makes them and gives them the same ruling. And anybody, brothers, today. الْمُتَأَمِّلُ فِي وَاقِعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ الْيَوْمِ. If you look at the situation of the Muslims today, especially you focus on فِي مَا يُنْشَرُ, the things that are spread, the articles that are written, you realize that عدم الضبط والفهم, lack of precision in knowledge and lack of comprehension in knowledge, هو سمة البارزة, it is the true sign that is prevalent amongst the Muslims today. Especially في ذل وسائل التواصل الاجتماعي, especially on social media. Social media, has opened the doors for every single person to put forward what he believes. Everybody, كل يقول ما يشاء. Every single person comes and he says what he wants. One person will come, he will speak about a matter, يتبعه الآلاف, 1,000 people are going to follow him. Rather, بل ملايين, millions. So this person becomes fascinated with himself, and then he starts to speak about more issues of knowledge, ويتخبط فيه, and then he comes with contradiction, things that are incorrect. Comes with fatawa غريبة, شاذة, that goes against the قواعد and the أصول. And the reason for that fitna that's happening is that the ummah is suffering from is due to عدم فهم العلم وضبطه. There's no comprehension of knowledge, and there is also no precision in it. How has the ideology of ISIS and the Khawarij, قديم الزمان, before and even till today, how has it spread? إلا بسبب الجهل. The reason why it spread is because of ignorance. And the people got affected by these people, the ignorant individuals. The people who did not have ضبط العلم, who didn't understand knowledge, started to become affected by these Khawarij. And they themselves, they didn't have ضبط العلم and فهم العلم. He has an ayah with him, he's memorized the ayah, he's memorized the hadith, لكن لا فهم له. He has no comprehension. And we hear أقوال شاذة in issues of fiqh, hadith, and usul, in fundamental issues of the religion. Based on that, my beloved brothers and sisters, it becomes clear to each and every one of us the importance, أهمية فهم العلم وضبطه, the importance of comprehending knowledge, having precision in knowledge, and giving importance to this part or this topic, how important it is, it becomes clear to us. For example, we have an issue of that we suffer from today, ما تعانيه الأمة اليوم, which is the issue of الاستحلال مثلا. We have استحلال as an Islamic concept. استحلال is making halal something Allah تبارك وتعالى and His Messenger made haram. This is called استحلال. And استحلال is of two types. استحلال عقدي اعتقادي and استحلال عملي. استحلال اعتقادي means the استحلال that comes from the heart. And there's an استحلال that comes from the limbs. أهل السنة والجماعة, they made تكفير of استحلال on the one that is اعتقادي, not the استحلال which is عملي. In other words, a person who drinks alcohol excessively is not a kafir, even if he's musir, he's consistent upon it for 40 years. This is istihlal amali, but it's not istihlal i'tiqadi, unless he says with his tongue, I believe khamar is halal, then it becomes istihlal aqdi, i'tiqadi. And this makes him leave the fold of Islam. So a group of people who haven't understood, they read some of the statements of the scholars, and they didn't understand which is istihlal, which is mukaffir, al-mukhrij min al-millah, the istihlal that would take you out of Islam. They didn't understand this, which of the two it is. So they made takfir of any person who comes with istihlal amali. For example, what falls under istihlal amali is the Muslim leader opening banks. البنوك الربوية, banks. This is استحلال عملي. أما إباحة عملي. He permits it, legislates it for the people to open banks. is this from the istihlal, which the past, the ruler leaves al-Islam for? La. Because it is not istihlal i'tiqadi, unless that leader says, I believe bunuk riba, we are permissible and it's halal, then this individual or this leader becomes kafir for that statement. And this is what the ulama said, Kashaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and others of Kashaykh ibn Uthaymiyyah rahimahullah, that the dabid of istihlal, which is mukaffir, al-mukhrij min al-millah, is when it is i'tiqadi and not when it is amali. So why did this problem occur to these group of people? Fahmu al-ilm. And there is no dabd, there's no precision on these terminologies that the scholars are using, what they mean by it. So they just take the nusus like that and they use. Another group of people we have who've fallen into the same extreme. We have the extreme of at-takfir on one side, and we have those who fall into tabdi', placing bid'ah on a person. What we know is, as Imam Ahmad said, إخراج الناس عن السنة شديد. Taking the people out of the sunnah and saying that they are innovators is a very severe issue. It's not a very light issue. And that one should not take it very lightly. So what is it that which a person can become an innovator on? In other words, متى يبدع المعين? When can a person be labeled as an innovator? That brings the point of then understanding what is the usul Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are upon, and that anyone who leaves it, he leaves Ahlul Sunnah before you place this ruling on them. As we know, two things are min usul Ahlul Sunnah. The first one is مزدر التلقي, the sources which Ahlul Sunnah take their religion from. And it's al-kitabu wal-sunnatu wal-ijma'. If a person does not take the kitab or the sunnah or the ijma', يُحْكَمُ عَلَيْهِ مُبَاشَرَةً بِالتَّبْدِيعِ, this person is a mubtadi' straight away. If he doesn't take the kitab or the sunnah or the ijma' as a source of evidence, then that person is an innovator straight away. No ifs, no buts. Why? لأنه خالف أهل السنة في مزدر التلقي. He went against أهل السنة in the kitab or the sunnah or the ijma. He's a mubtadi'. The second one is خالف, he opposes أهل السنة في المسائل المجمع عليه عند السلف. He goes against أهل السنة in a matter which Ahlul Sunnah are unanimously in agreement upon. They unanimously agree with each other on this issue. Meaning there's no khilaf, there's no dispute amongst Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This ruling, they don't differ. They have one word in it. The person who opposes Ahlul Sunnah in this issue, تُقَامُ عَلَيْهِ الْحُجَّةِ, the proof is established on him. وَتُزَالُ عَنْهُ الشُّبْهَ, and the doubt that's there for him is removed. He's told, look, this is what you're saying, this is the proof. All his doubts are responded to. فَإِنْ أَصَرَّ, after removing the doubt from him, establishing the proof on him, if he's still consistent and he's persistent upon it, يُحْكَمُ عَلَيْهِ بِالتَّبْدِيعِ, then he's labeled as a مُبْتَدَى. After you establish the proof on him, you've removed the doubts from him, if he's consistent upon it, you say he's a mubtada. A group of people do not distinguish between the two. The first one, what did I say? If he goes against Ahlul Sunnah in the Masdar al-Talaqi, يُحْكَبُ بِالتَّبْدِيعِ مُبَاشَرَةً, straight away he's labeled as a mubtada. No hujja is established on him, and there's no proof, there's no doubts that's removed from him. There isn't. Because from the get-go, you want even Ahlul Sunnah. If you go against him from the kitab or the sunnah, you say, I don't take the kitab, or I don't take the sunnah, or ijma' you're talking about, that's not for me, I don't take it. You're a mubtadi'. The second one, لكن the مسائل أهل السنة are unanimously agreed upon. This person, proof is established on him. Once the proof is established on him and it's brought to his attention, if he says, I still don't want to take it, يُحْكَمُ عَلَيْهِ بِالتَّبْدِيعِ. If that is not done, then what happens is الغلو في التبديع. Extremism in تبديع. And where did that come from? عدم ضبط العلم. This person has not got precision in knowledge. He has not got precision in knowledge. And he hasn't understood علم. So that's why we're finding these extremes. You have the opposites of all of those groups. You have those liberals who would say to you, the Asha'ira and the Maturidiyya and the Athariyya are all Ahlul Sunnah. They want to bring every single person in that. So he will say to you, the Ash'ari is Ahlul Sunnah. The Maturidi is Ahlul Sunnah. And the Athari is Ahlul Sunnah. When you say to him, where did you get this from? He'll say, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, the Asha'ir of Ahlul Sunnah. But due to his lack of understanding and comprehending that according to the ulama statement is that the Mustalah Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah has a usage which is general and it has a usage which is specific. So when they say that the Asha'ira are Ahlul Sunnah, they mean when we look at them in regards to the Rafida. They're Sunnis. But when we look at Ahlul Sunnah within the realms, they're not. ولذلك Ibn Taymiyyah says clearly, he says, فلفظ أهل السنة يراد به من أثبت خلافة الخلفاء الثلاثة فيدخل في ذلك جميع الطوائف إلا الرافضة. You see? All the groups will fall under أهل السنة when we look at them from, when we're comparing them to the رافضة. فيدخل في ذلك حتى المعتزلة. Ibn Taymiyyah said even the معتزلة will enter أهل السنة, but the usage which is عام. وقد يراد بأهل الحديث والسنة المحضة فلا يدخل فيه إلا من يثبت الصفات لله تعالى. And there's a second usage, which is what? The أهل الحديث والسنة are only referred to as أهل السنة. المحضة, the pure ones. فلا يدخل فيه إلا من يثبت الصفات. The only person who's going to enter the أهل السنة الخاصة is the ones who affirm Allah's characteristics and attributes. You see, my beloved brothers and sisters, and Ibn Taymiyyah explains this in more details in his Sharh of Al-Asfahaniyah. So where did this problem come from? It came from عدم الفهم وضبط العلم. Lack of understanding and not comprehending. Those issues were عقيدة related matters. They were عقيدة related. Issues that there was no ضبط العلم. Or manhaj related issues. Now let's go to issues that are al-khata' fi al-masail al-far'iyya, ma masail al-fiqhiyya. Al-khata' fi al-masail al-fiqhiyya. Like you see mistakes that people come with in matters of fiqh. Due to adam al-fahmi lil-ilmi wa dabti. For instance, not being able to distinguish between milku al-manfa'a and maliku al-intifa'a. What's the difference between ملك المنفعة and مالك الانتفاع? What's the difference between the two? And having خلل deficiency in not being able to distinguish between what is ملك المنفعة and مالك الانتفاع brings a lot of destructive rulings. And what's the difference between the two? ملك المنفع عن مالك الانتفاع is a person can go to a masjid and benefit from it. Okay? He can benefit from this masjid. And he can sleep in the masjid. And he can read Quran in the masjid. Okay? And he can sit there all day. No one's going to stop him. Also, the main public roads, you're allowed to drive on it. You're allowed to benefit from this place. But can you say, because I'm benefiting from the masjid, I can now go and sell the masjid? Whereas your house, not only are you able to benefit from it, but you're also able to sell it and benefit money from it and gain something from it. So the fuqaha distinguish between what is milkul manfa'ah and malikul intifa'ah. Here, this person has the rights to benefit, but he doesn't have the rights to say, I'm benefiting from it, so I'm allowed to sell it and get more benefit from it. And because of this, you see fatawat which are غريب, shad, ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان. Other issues that you see people fall deficient in is the issue of الفرق بين من باشر النجاسة في الصلاة ناسيا لم تبطل صلاته. You see, sometimes the fuqaha, they say, the person who comes in contact with impurity whilst in the prayer, but he does it forgetfulness. He comes into contact with an impure place, something impure. Okay? For example, there's something that's there, that's urine or whatnot, and he by accident, out of forgetfulness, he puts his hand in there, in the salah, مثلا. His hand falls in there by accident. Or which other way? لم تبطل صلاته. His salah is not nullified. You hear some scholars, they say that. Imam Shafi'i said in his Qawl al-Qadim, and Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah, he strengthens this opinion very strong, even in his al-Majmu'u, which is a sharh of Muhaddab al-Ishaq al-Shirazi. He states this is Qawl is قوي من الدليل وهو المختار. This is strong in terms of the evidence and it's the chosen opinion, he says. Imam Ahmad, from one of his riwayat, he says that. And it is rather the madhab of the Hanabila, I believe. It's also the view held by Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Ata' ibn Abi Rabah and Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib and Dawus ibn Kaysan and Salim, Mawla Hudayfa and Mujahid and Sha'bi, Amr ibn Sharhabil and Zuhri and Nakha'i and Hassan al-Basri, Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Ansari, Al-Awza'i, Ishaq ibn Rahuya, Abu Thawri, rahimahullahu ta'ala. All of them, they hold that opinion. Now, let's look at another issue that's related to this. And that is what? The issue of leaving off a wajib thing in the salah out of forgetfulness. Those same scholars, they say that he has to come back with that prayer again. So you're in the salah, you forget something that is wajib, wajib min al-wajibat al-salah. Fard min furud al-salah, you leave it. They say you have to come back with it. But now we have what? If you what? If you've touched and you came into contact with an impurity whilst in the salah, out of forgetfulness, you don't have to come back with that salah. And your salah is correct. Whereas if you leave a wajib out of forgetfulness, you have to bring back that prayer. How does that work? The reason the asal or this issue it revolves around is, and this is what the person has to understand, and once you don't understand this issue, is al-farqu, the difference between what? فعل المحظور ناسيا and ترك المحظور ترك المأمور ناسيا. The fuqaha and the usuliyin, they ponder and they look at doing an impermissible act out of forgetfulness and leaving of a command out of forgetfulness is different. Doing something that's prohibited is not the same as leaving off something that is obligatory. You have to know the difference here. And because you don't distinguish between those two, you want to always make it the same. And your fatwa is going to be غريب. And your rulings are going to be shocking.